Joining us on Loudwire Nights tonight is Blake Bedsaul, frontman for the band Saul, which kind of gives me Hailstorm vibes, right? Because their band name also inspired by their last name. There's also siblings in that group. Your brother Zach, a huge part of the band as guitarist and writer along with you. Were you guys writing songs as kids? Like, did you do the same like talent show for your parents thing?
Not so much. I mean, we always did talent shows when it came through in like junior high and high school for sure, but not so much as kids.
Not so much as kids. All right, let's go back and start at kind of the beginning, because your band is proof that you can come from a small town, be unsigned, and then just have this song really click with listeners, and now you're on a national level. So how did this all play out? And I know it's like one of those overnight success things, which is never overnight, because in 2016, you were like best local metal band, but tell us the backstory.
So yeah, we're from a real small town, grew up in a town of like 650, 700 people. And with the bringing of social media, that's really what elevates, you know, and gets people out there. So, I mean, anybody out there listening that's from a small town, who cares? You really don't have to move anywhere. I mean, live where it's cheap, you know, it helps you out in the long run. You know, I really like coming from a small town. I don't think I'd ever leave these areas. I like it out here. It's real quiet and, you know, nobody really bothers you. And it is a little harder coming from a small town because you don't have such major markets. But, I mean, we're an hour from Sioux City, a little ways from Sioux Falls. Minneapolis is pretty close. Omaha's pretty close. So, I mean, just get ready to get out and play.
In my head, everybody in Iowa loves Slipknot, and I don't know why. Is that even true?
Yes.
Okay. I just assume that for no apparent reason. But how did the band, so you guys were doing things locally, and then how did you get from that to like the next level? Obviously, you put out Brother, which we're going to talk about in a minute, but when did the recognition start to come?
You know, we did some member changes, and we had to change up the way we were feeling about things. We got William McRavy in on bass, so I stepped down from doing bass lead vocals, just went to vocals. We got William in, and we got Joe in on drums, and he's gorilla hands. He hits so hard and heavy. So, I mean, it was a good change of pace for us rather than being more math rock, math metal. And that's when everybody started to notice. The live show really started to take off, and people were starting to recognize that, and we brought in our light production, and we really focused on bringing the best show possible rather than strictly focusing on the music, you know, being really Tool influenced and Tool vibed. Really, the only thing we focused on was time signatures and juxtapositions and just focusing on the music. And we just decided to go completely different route and, you know, go a little more Motley Crue and just bring the show and then do it that way. That's when people really started to take the notice.
Nice. What is math rock or math metal?
Well, we played in a lot of different time signatures. Right before we changed things up, we were working on stuff in 15 and 13 and 5-4, 7-8, you know, stuff like that, you know, the standards are 4-4 and 6-8. So, I mean, we just stuck with that because that's where everybody grooves at. And that's the funnest songs to play live, really.
Oh, okay, cool. All right, let's talk about the song that's bringing the band this great recognition right now, Brother, which manages to be, you know, very personal yet relatable to anybody who's had a loss in their life.
You know, it's kind of crazy. Zach and I wrote the song pretty introspective, you know, just a release for us. And everybody, I mean, it connects with literally everybody because they've either lost a brother or a best friend. I mean, and it goes for male and female alike, you know, where they can connect with it. I say brother, but I mean, it goes bigger than that. It goes, you know, police and military as well. So you want the backstory on that song?
Yeah, I mean, I do. But I also, there's like a little part of me that's like, God, it's so intrusive that you have to kind of relive that backstory all the time. Is it?
I've kind of gotten used to it now. First couple times, it was pretty hard to talk about it because for a long time as a family, we didn't really talk about it. It just kind of happened and we, you know, we only talked about the good times. We didn't talk about what went down with it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah. If you don't mind sharing the backstory for our listeners, I know it, but for our listeners' sake.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a while ago. So 2009, Zach and I lost our older brother. He was the first case in Iowa from H1N1 when the swine flu and all that stuff was coming through. Couldn't figure out what was wrong with him. And his organs were shutting down. His lungs filled up with fluid. Anyway, like 4 days after he was put in the hospital, he passed away. They didn't know how. They ran all the tests, and it turned out it was H1N1. And so that's the story. That's what, I mean, every lyric in the song is describing a point in from the time he went to the hospital to the moment he died. And that's why I think, I mean, I was saying real stuff and real facts about what happened. And the crazy part about it is we were on the hunt for a drummer. Our drummer at the time had just left the band. And so we were on the hunt. We get hit up by Joe Nichols, and he's not far away, right there in Lamar's, Iowa. So we send him the material, say, hey, you know, if you want to try out, this is the stuff you got to learn. And the second he heard Brother, he called Zach and said, hey, I lost my brother in 2011 from an IED in Afghanistan. I have to be in the band. Well, it just turns out he slams on drums too. So it was perfect, serendipitous the way it worked out.
That is so crazy. That is, I mean, what are the odds? Yeah. That's insane. How did your family react to the song?
Oh, there were tears for a while. And, you know, and after they got past the fact of, like really what it's about, I mean, everybody just started rocking out to it. Just thinking of it as more of a rock song rather than, what it's about really.
Right. Okay, thank you for sharing that. The Eons EP is out, but you just wrapped recording the debut album. So what was that experience like?
Oh, it was good. It was fast. You know, usually Zach and I, we take a while to write a record. We'll take, you know, a year and put out an EP, but we'll have a couple songs on the back burner. And yeah, we slammed out the 7 songs in a month. I'm glad we had some ideas on the back burner. And working with Chris Dawson down at Aphotic Studios in Wichita, and we had our buddy Jimmy Beatty, and they were both in the band Seasons After. And we had them come out and, you know, do their thing. And we just, well, I think we put out, that's going to be the best material we have.
Yeah, well, musicians always say that. I've heard that before.
Yeah, true.
But I'm sure you do believe it as well. So are some of the songs carryovers from the Eons EP?
Yes, that is the plan. For the full record, we are going to include the Eons EP and just make it a full-length record with the 7 new songs.
Okay.
And, yeah, a couple little surprises sprinkled in there as well.
Sounds good. Everybody loves surprises. I know it's like impossible to describe a sound, but if you could, for our listeners who aren't super familiar with your work.
We classify our genre as like progressive mainstream because we did come from a pretty progressive band. We'd like to keep that element just a little bit, you know, so, but we like to stick to the mainstream. It's some of the best songs, and you'll have musicians out there be like, oh, you know, selling out or what, you know, whatever. Personally, you can write more from the heart based on if you stick to not to sell, but to just be upfront and write songs that connects with you and everyone on a personal level.
You guys are hitting the road with Light the Torch soon. I know you've done festivals, you've done shows. Are you, I guess since you're kind of like a newer band, right? Are you touring in a van, I'm assuming? Van life?
Yes, hopefully not for much longer.
We
just got a brand new 15-passenger, our old van Muta. Oh, she's seen some road days. So, yeah, we finally got a new one and new trailer. Yeah, so it'll be cool.
Congratulations on that. I was going to ask, is van life as hellish as I would just, as a non-musician, assume it is?
Yeah, yes, it is stinky. It's long days. Yeah, close quarters. But, I mean, it's cool. Everybody, once we get out and we're at the venue, everybody's happy and cool. I mean, we're all best friends. So, I mean, I couldn't do it with anybody that that I guess I didn't like.
Yeah, of course. You call your fans equals, and I feel like I should maybe know what that means, but I do not. So can you explain?
Well, I think for a long time, bands may have disconnected with their fans in the realization that you're only where you're at because of them. Them buying the records, paying, come to your shows, you know, just hitting me up on Facebook or Instagram saying how much you changed their lives and stuff like that. So we thought about it for a long time. And so our slogan is Rise as Equals. And, you know, we may be the ones, you know, writing the songs and you know, performing. But I think all of our fans are part of the band, just equally as important as we are.
Ah, okay. Got it. Sturgis coming up for you all. Have you ever been? Do you know how to ride a motorcycle? Do you have that adrenaline junkie thing in you?
You know, I've never ridden a motorcycle. I've driven side-by-sides and four-wheelers and stuff like that. I've never been on a hog, but yeah, I they're cool. They're cool. I mean, I like them, but yeah, just never had the opportunity. Never taken the time, I guess.
What's the most adrenaline-inducing thing you've done for fun in your life?
Oh, adrenaline? Oh, man. Okay. I don't like the water. I really hate the water. And we took a ferry across the Puget Sound. That was pretty adrenaline rushing for me.
Okay. That does not count.
I'm blaming. There's going to be people like, I do that stuff every day. But yeah, not for me. I'm Midwest. I'm landlocked. I don't even go on the lake.
That is so funny. Do you know how to swim?
No.
Oh, there you go. That's why it's so scary.
I can't float. I don't know what it is. I sink to the bottom directly as soon as I get in.
That's hilarious.
Maybe it's my bald head. I don't know what it is.
I don't know what it is. right? I feel like some people literally just cannot. They don't. I don't know what, why. I don't know how that works. But I do think some people just can't do it. That's so funny. Who do you look up to? Like, what band in terms of, you know, you'd like to emulate their path to success?
You know, definitely Nothing More.
Oh, I love Nothing
More. I think, oh, man. We love them, too. You know, they have a message of, like, hope and, like, inspiration, and that's something that we're trying to do as well. And you know, they've kind of just become masters of it, and if we can emulate them even to a small percent, I mean, I think that's where we will feel successful.
Yeah, that they are a great band. This was trending on Twitter the other day, so I'll ask it for fun, and this will be our last question. First concert, last concert, next concert, and best concert.
Okay, my very first concert was Killswitch Engaged and the Used at the Taste of Chaos in Des Moines, Iowa. Best concert I've ever been to was Tool in Cedar Rapids. The last concert I went to was Def Leppard and Kiss, also in Des Moines. Hmm. Oh, and I got to tell you, I never grew up being a huge Def Leppard fan, but they blew me away when I saw them down in Des Moines. I was highly, highly impressed.
Really? I've never seen them live.
Yeah, I do recommend it.
And I'm just going to go ahead and assume next concert is a Saul concert.
yes, it is. I mean, we're opening for Killswitch, Clutch, and In This Moment in Sioux City, so I'm looking forward to being in the crowd for that, too.
So cool. What else? What else is coming up for the band? What do I need to know? What did I not touch on?
Well, everybody, if our easiest access to us is saulofficial.com, and I know we have a lot of people asking us, but we do have an online merch store coming up where you can order everything. And, I mean, you'll get everything from hats to hoodies to shirts to tanks. I mean, so that is coming. That's in the works, and it's almost finalized. So, yeah, make sure you're sporting a Saul shirt. That's about it. New record coming out. Yeah, we're just super excited to be doing what we're doing.
Yeah, I bet you are. Is there a timeline for the new album or when you'll be maybe like a season, a name, anything you could give us at this point or nothing?
You know, I'm just going to say maybe the fall. I don't know. I don't know. Mm-hmm. And that might be premature. I might get yelled at about it, but yeah.
No, it's just a ballpark figure. We won't hold you to it. It's fine.
Yeah.
All right. Sounds good. Blake Bedsaul, many thanks for your time, man. We'll be on the lookout for that record, and just continued success to you and your bandmates.
Great. Thanks, Toni.
Thank you, man.